to be here today. All thanks and glory to our Heavenly Father for giving us another opportunity to witness another Sabbath. It's not by our power, not by our might, but by His grace and His mercy. That is why we are still alive. Many people, they have different perceptions about God. They have different views about the nature of God. Who really is God? Some people, they see God as good because of their experience with God. Some people, they see God as evil because of their experience with God as well. But some people, they see God both as good and evil. But what does the Bible call God? And how does the Bible explain the nature of God? The Bible tells us that God is evil or good or both good and evil. Let us just look at it. The head of today's second speech sermon should be able to know the actual nature of God. And when you look at the fourth book of John, chapter 4, verse 8, not only there. There we see that God said, Bible said that God is love. If God is love, how does somebody that Bible term love the evil? You have to consider that. When you see a lot of things that's happening to humanity presently, everybody can just conclude that God is evil. I've seen a lot of people that will tell me that they have read throughout the Bible from Genesis to Revelation. Everything that God there is evil. God always punishes people. God always destroys people. Well, he has his own point. But is it biblical? Is it what Bible tells that? The Bible is the nature of God. There are some people that say that no, God can never be evil. God is always faithful. God is good. And he will tell you that if you look throughout the pages of the Bible, everything about God is good. So, today's message is what I will call our title, the nature of God, good or evil. The nature of God, good or evil. For the first passage, let us look at the book of 2 Corinthians and see what the Bible tells us about God. 2 book of Corinthians, chapter 13. 2 book of Corinthians, 13, verse 11. Finally, brethren, farewell, be perfect, be of good comfort, be of one mind, live in peace, and the God of love and peace shall be with you. You see that here, Paul made us to understand that God is the God of love and peace. He can never be evil. He always have peace in our life. Yes, there are a God of love and God of peace. So when you see that a loving God can never be evil, many people, they have that dangerous perception that God is evil because of what has happened to them. And they always use some verses in the Bible to buttress that point. And one of the verses that they always use in the Bible is the book of Isaiah. They always use that place to specifically state that if God can say something about himself, then actually God is evil. Let us talk to the book of Isaiah, see what they are, see how they use this particular passage to describe the nature of God. The book of Isaiah. Isaiah 45. Isaiah 45. Verse 7. I form the light and create darkness. I make peace and create evil. You can see that. And create evil. I make peace and create evil. Let's just follow that. How did Lord do all these things? You can see that God was one speaking here. He said, I create evil, I make peace. I said, how did Lord do all these things? people just conclude that God is evil. That means God is evil. For him to be, to basically say that he creates evil. But when we look at Bible passages very well, we know that the same book of Isaiah said that peace of us, peace is land of online. We understand the word of God. We can't use only this verse to just reach conclusion to jump to conclude that God is evil. We still need to read other Bible verses to know whether God is evil or God is good. And that will make up to have a better perception about the nature of God. When we say that I create evil and I make peace, remember that the other time, the other passage that we read, 2 Corinthians 13, verse 11, is the God of peace. He called himself God of love, God of peace. But here now he said that he created evil, he created peace. He made all these things. So how do we now be concerned? The God of peace, the God of love, the God that creates evil. Let us look at the book of Amos and see what is there. And see how God actually explained to Amos his nature. When you read this book of Amos, you will be able to know actually the nature of God. Amos chapter 3, verse 6, the book of Amos, chapter 3, verse 6, you shall see what God said. Shall the trumpet be blown in the street, and the people not be afraid? Now let's read this one. Shall there be evil in the city, and the blood has not done it? You can just jump from here that God is evil. Can there be evil in the city without God not be aware of it? Everybody can just look at it and say, yes, that God is the one doing the evil in the city. Many people will try to shift it and say, no, it's Satan that is doing it, not actually God. But when we look at this place, he said that God is aware of that evil in the city. God that is the one doing the evil in the city. He didn't say Satan, he said God is the one doing the city. When we look at this, we have to reconcile this in Amos 3 verse 6 and Isaiah 45 verse 10 and see whether it is God that is doing this thing, or always from our own perspective, or from other people's perspective. When we are able to know and reconcile the two of them together, so that we will be able to have a better understanding of what God is actually trying to tell us. Because God said that He is a God of love. He's a God of love. How can a God of love be supporting an evil in the city? Then we have to look at that. You cannot jump to conclusion like that. That kind of erroneous belief is very, very dangerous. Because the Most High can never be evil. You should know that when we read through the two of the Bible very well, God is completely good. He's completely good. When we let go to the book of Isaiah. The book of Isaiah. Isaiah 50. No, Isaiah 5. Chapter 5. The book of Isaiah. Chapter 5. Verse 20. Here we'll be able to know how actually what evil is. Isaiah chapter 5. Verse 20. Woe unto them that call evil good and good evil. That put darkness for light and light for darkness. That put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. You can see that. Look at that. Woe unto people that call evil good. When you say God is good, but I'm not saying God is evil at the same time. You can't say something that is good and say it's evil. You can't say that word to that person. And you can't say evil, you can't call evil good. But you can't say that word to another person. You have to know the difference between the good and the evil. And you have to call the spirit spirit. You have to call it good, something that is good, good. Something that is evil, evil. You don't have to call somebody that is either good or evil. Or you have to know what the two combination together. You can't say God is good and evil at the same time. It's not possible. It's either you think it's good or it's evil. That's why God has said that when you see good and you call it evil, it's a war to such a person. God can never be evil. We have to see that a God of love can never be evil to us. He can never do anything bad to us. It can be depends on our perspective. The way you perceive him. of children of Israel. You can just conclude that God is evil. When God called them out of the land of Egypt, God gave them instruction to follow. But when they disobeyed God, evil happened unto them. Is it God that caused the evil? We need to think deeply and know why this evil happened to them. Turn to the book of 1 John. The book of 1 John. And see how Apostle John described the nature of God here. Whether it's good or evil. We should be able to know the book of 1 John. 1 John chapter 1. Verse 5. This then is the message which we have heard and declare unto you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. God is light. There is no darkness in him at all. And what does light symbolize? Light symbolizes good. Darkness symbolizes evil. And there is no darkness. Yeah, you say that there is no darkness in God. How can you say that evil in God? When God says that there is no darkness in him. And he said he's a God of light. When God says that he's a God of light, that means he's a God that's very good. There's no evil in him at all. Because God can never be light and darkness at the same time. Darkness cannot stand where God is. God will always be light. His light will always be shining upon us. There's no way darkness can have anywhere to hide as far as God is here. And when you look at evil people, the evil in there, they perpetrate their evil to darkness. We mean that God is light and God is not darkness. You can see that he said that God is light and in him there is no darkness at all. No darkness at all. That means pure bright, pure light. So you can see that God is good. There is no evil in God at all. There is no evil in him at all. But when we look at the book of Isaiah 45, verse 7, you tend to misinterpret that God is evil. God is a great evil. And when we say that evil is a city, God is aware of it. But when you remember that perspective, God is when we perceive what God, how God deals with us. When we disobey God, automatically evil will fall upon us. But when all this is not happening to us, how do we be God? How do we see God? We see God as evil. And God is punishing us. And why is God punishing us? I don't know man who can make mistakes, but why is not God controlling God? We see him as an evil God, but God is not evil. God will never do anything that will hurt us. But we should know that we are suffering because of the consequences of what we have done, consequences of our action. Whatever we sow, we shall reap it. Whatever we sow, we shall reap it. You can't be a smoker, you can't be a chain smoker. And later how somebody now, that means, the person is not that good. Of having cancer. And I said, I have not allowed him to have cancer. It's suffering because of the consequences of what they have done. When you tend to look at God and say, okay, God, you are punishing me because of this, you are evil. You are evil towards me. But God, we should always remember that God is always there for us. God can never be evil. There is no darkness in him. And when we face all this judgment, we see them as being too harsh upon us, because we see that God's judgment is too harsh upon us because of our suffering or what we have done in the past. But when we accept this judgment in good faith, we shall be with God in the hell. We shall be happy. Because we all think we tend to look at God, I mean, our own wisdom is not that like that of God. God's wisdom is beyond our own comprehension. We cannot just see things the way God sees things. God sees things broadly, see things afar, see things in future, but we see things immediately. So we tend to see that, okay, when God is punishing us now, then God is giving evil to us. We can see that we perceive, and that is what is happening. Okay, let's look for an example now. Let me just say somebody is planning to do evil, and God now asks us to say, okay, this person is planning evil towards you now. Tell me what towards you, what you mean, planning to come to something bad to happen to you. And in the process, God now reveals to you that, okay, this person is planning to do this to you. In the process of trying to do that evil to you, maybe he had an accident or something just happened and became destabilized and became paralyzed. In your own heart, in your own perspective, God is good. Isn't it? Because God punishes someone that wants to hurt you. But the other way around, that person will see that God is punishing him for trying to commit evil. You can see that we view the way God passes judgment through our own personal experience. When we see something that favors us, we say that we tend to say that God is good, that God's judgment is perfect. But when we see something that goes against us, maybe something that we know that we cannot endure it because of the pain, because of the emotional breakdown or whatever, then we tend to blame God. How can a loving God allow this kind of thing to happen to you? You should know that God allows everything to happen in our life for our own good, for our own purpose, and for His own will. And if God is correcting someone for something He did, it's just like a parental correction. Like a parental correction. For example, now, if your child is behaving and trying to do something that is not proper, and you pull it aside, the child will look at you and say, my dad is very wicked. Can you always beat me? My dad is very wicked. Why can't he still be wicked to me like this? But the parent that is punishing the child is not wicked. He's trying to make the child become something in life. When I was still young, I still remember the way my mom used to punish me a lot. I always look at my mother, my mom is too wicked. Mom is too wicked. Anything that is, I even like my daddy and my mom, because I never beat me. Because anytime I happen like this, I want my daddy, my mom come and pick me and beat me. And then, okay, you done this something wrong again. You flogged me, so you flogged me alone. I always see my mommy as very wicked. He doesn't even like me. She hates me. But along the line, I began to realize that this woman meant good. And at the end of the day, I realized that all those things that she has done is to my own good. It's not my own good. It's my own good. So I've become a better person in life. So God is like that. When you are facing anything that is not present in our life, you should always remember that God is always there for us. The way He views us, He wants better things for us. He wants good for us to happen in our life. Let's go talk to the book of Proverbs. Proverbs chapter 3. Proverbs 3. Verse 11. My son, despite not the chastening of the Lord, neither be weary of His correction. Verse 12 now. For whom the Lord loveth, He corrected, even as father, the son in whom He delighted. You can see that when the father loved the son, He corrected. So, I'm not liking that word to hold that. When God is chastening us, you should not complain. Do not complain. You don't accept it in good faith. Because God loves us. You should know that the ultimate purpose of that suffering, the ultimate purpose of that what we see as evil in our life is God's love for us. God's love for us. So in other words, you need to see what you see as evil from God is actually good things from God. That's in other words. When we see anything that God is pointing on, we should know that God actually really loves us. He really plans good things for us. Bible said that God has good thoughts for us, has a good things for us, has a good plan for us. He can never think of evil for us. He knows that we need good things in our life. So He can never or won't plan evil against us. Book of Psalms. Psalms verse 5. Chapter 5, book of Psalms. Chapter 5. Verse 4. For you are not a God that hath pleasure with wickedness, neither shall evil dwell with thee. You can see that God is not a God that hath pleasure with wickedness. It's not a God that hath pleasure with wickedness. When you see people fighting wars, you see children dying, say, tell us how to say that. But you see that God allowed it cannot to happen. Why is that people are dying? You see a book where you see a lot of people, you don't bomb a mosque, bomb a church. Why is it that you keep on worrying now? Why is it that God allowed all these things to happen? But tell us that there is no wickedness in God. He doesn't have pleasure in wickedness. And evil can never dwell with him. According to this verse, evil can never dwell with him. So we can see that God can never abhor evil. He can never live with evil. God is the God of life. He can never live with darkness. So we can say that actually God's love, from our own perspective, when we are undergoing a difficult experience, we might think God's love for us is evil. Whereas he meant good things for us. Likewise, if you are involved in sin and you think that then you cannot continue to go away from it, then when God's judgment comes upon you, you need to accept it. Because whatever we say, we shall read. Let us turn to the book of Galatians. Book of Galatians 6. Chapter 6. Galatians chapter 6. Verse 8. For he that sweat to his flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption. But he that sweat to the spirit shall of the spirit reap life everlasting. You can see when you do something in the flesh, when you sow to the flesh, ultimately you reap corruption, But when you sow into the spirit, ultimately you reap everlasting life. It's just like a very simple answer. And it is. God does not mix words together. He will tell you the way it is. When you sow into the flesh, when you are doing something that you know that is dangerous to your life, and when you are now reaping the consequences, obviously you should know that that is corruption of part of it. But when you sow into spirit, obviously you have everlasting life. You have everlasting life. So that means when we know, when we want to, if at all we really want to avoid the evil of what we call evil from God, then ultimately we have to know how to avoid something that will make those evil to come upon us. Ultimately we can avoid it. When we really want to do it, we can really avoid it. Now let's turn to the book of Jeremiah, chapter 6. The book of Jeremiah 6. I will start reading from verse 16. Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 16. Thus said the Lord, stand ye in the way and see, and heart for the whole path. Where is the good way, and walk near him, and ye shall find rest for your soul. But they said, do not walk near him. Because he said that God is talking to the children of Israel. God asked them to go back to the whole path and walk near him. But they still lie like they can never walk near him. They need to walk on the right way. Now let's read further. Verse 17. Now also I sent watchmen over you, saying, hearken to the sound of the trumpet. But he said, you will not hearken. You see that God is warning them. Walk in the whole way. Walk in my way. They refuse. Listen to the trumpet. The watchman is there. Hearken to the sound of the trumpet. They didn't listen. They refused to listen. Let's go further to verse 18. Therefore, hear, ye nation, and know, O congregation, what is among them. Hear, O heart. Behold, I will bring evil upon these people. You can see. God said, he's going to bring evil upon them. When God wants them to follow him, to follow his way, they refuse. Ultimately, evil will fall upon them. God has what God said. God will bring evil upon them. And when God has said, you not see God as God of evil. You see God as, how can God bring evil upon us? But you will never remember that you refuse to listen to God. Let's read further. Here I hope, behold, I will bring evil upon these people, even the fruit of their thoughts, before they have not hearkened unto my word, nor to my law, but rejected it. See the reason why God put evil upon them. He has a reason for it, put evil upon them. But not really evil per se, but he stands as evil, because he knew that they are going to suffer from the consequences of it. That's why God comes as evil. You know that evil is not evil per se. But when you look at it, later on, you see that it's not actually evil. Let us read further. Verse 20 now. To what purpose cometh there to me incense from Sheba, and the sweet cane from the far country? Your burnt offering are not accepting, but your sacrifice is sweet unto me. Let's jump down to verse 22 now. Thus said the Lord, behold, a people cometh from the north country, and a great nation shall be weighed from the side of the heart. You can see that the evil that God said he going to bring upon the children of Israel is that a great nation will come upon them that will sweep them away, that will take them as captives. Verse 23, let's go further. They shall be laid hold on bow and spear. They are cruel and have no mercy. Their voice roaring like the sea, and they ride upon horses, set in array as men for war against thee, O the God of time. You can see that God brought this evil upon the children of Israel because they refused to listen to him, they refused to follow his law, they rejected his way. And God now brought another country greater than them, more advanced than them, more advanced in the heart of God than them, and it destroyed them. And when the children of God were taken captive, God was there working them, isn't he? But to the children of Israel, God is evil. That was a simple prayer, the part of it. God is evil to the children of Israel. Because they were there, they were enjoying their lives. Then evil came upon them. A great nation came upon them, sweep them away. God is evil in their own perspective. But when we look at God, God is not evil to them. He wants them to learn, want them to listen, but he wants them to listen in a hard way. Because God has been telling them. It's perfect to them. Listen to them. And that is exactly what happened. When we were taken into captivity, we discovered that the children of Israel, in the captivity, they will repent. They will turn to God. They will beg God. God, please forgive us. We know that we have rejected you. We know that we sin against you. We don't regard it or not. Please accept us. God will now look at them. Have mercy upon them. You now return them back to their city. Then I mean, they will now see God that, oh, what God actually did to us is good. But when we were suffering, God is evil. So we should have that kind of perspective as well, that whatever that God does to us is not evil at all. It's for our own good. It's for his purpose. Now, this book of Isaiah 45 verse 7. When people tend to use it as well, that okay, if God is not evil, but God created evil, isn't it? If God can create evil, that means God was the one that created other idols. Yeah? Because he said, I created evil. God is the one that created homosexuality. Because God said, I created evil. When people use it to think that anything evil at all is from God. But no. When we look at the issue of homosexuality, we discover that this came as a result of lust or evil desire for men. And this can never come from God. And when we look at the issue of idol, God can never create idol. Because God said that I'm God, I'm not beside me. He is the ultimate God. He is the almighty one. He cannot just say, okay, this is another idol, suffering. He wants everybody to suffer. That's why he warned the children of Israel specifically that in the land they are going to inherit, don't serve other gods like other nations did. Because instead of because of what I don't understand, that is why you destroy them in their presence. So I will see that when the children of Israel, they actually trying to be like, emulate other nations by serving their God. And the Almighty God will destroy them and take them to captivity. And when they now realize their mistake, they will go back to God. Now, let us talk to the book of 1 Samuel. Book of 1 Samuel. First Samuel 18. Verse 10. And it came to pass on the morrow that the evil spirit from God came upon Saul, and he prophesied in the midst of the house. And the field tree played with his hand as at other times, and there was a gathering in David's, in Saul's hand. Now we can see that here, he said, evil spirit from the Lord. When people see that, they are after God said, how can you tell me that God is not evil? And here tell me that evil spirit from the Lord. That means that evil inside God, evil spirit from the Lord. When you look at this very way, you think that evil leads to God. But remember the other time I told you that darkness can never stay where God is. God is God of light. And evil cannot stay with God. What are these spirits that say evil spirits from the Lord? Remember that God created everything. He created every spirit. And all the spirits, they cannot do anything that is knowledge. And these spirits, they were created for their own purposes. For their own purposes. Now, you can see the issue of Saul disobeyed God. And the evil spirit came upon him. That is the purpose of that evil spirit. That is the work that he's supposed to do. And he's doing it perfectly. When we go to the book of Revelation, chapter 19, verse 2, I'm not telling you there. We will see that in the end time too, evil angels will come. Who created these angels? Are they the good angels that God created? Definitely no. They have their own purpose, they have their own work, they have their own role that they do there. God created them for that purpose. Even these people, they will come, they will grow together, they will pour the God wrath on people on the heart. And the people will suffer for the call, they disobey God. That's the purpose of those angels they were created for. It doesn't mean that these angels, they are from inside God. Because God is there as the God of life. No evil can be that. But he created this evil spirit and evil angel for their own purposes to work. They have their own roles. Just like in the game of the market, they have their own roles too. They go for errand. These evil spirits too, they go on their own errand too. They're not errand for God. But mind you, they can never do anything without God's knowledge. God has to approve it. They can't just say, okay, I want to do this thing. It's not possible. God has to know about it. When this evil spirit came upon Saul, God knows. God knew about it. That's why God has the evil spirit. Now let's go to the book of Proverbs 16. Book of Proverbs 16. Proverbs 16:4. The Lord had made all things, you can see that, he made all things for himself. Yea, even the wicked for the day of evil. You can see that God made all things for himself. Even the wicked for the day of evil. God made the wicked for the day of evil. God knew that the evil days would come, and he made the wicked for it. God knew that people would disobey, and God made the wicked angel. He made the evil angel, evil spirit, he made it for them. So that he will not be the one that will bring the world. These are the angels and the spirit that will bring the work, that will carry out his judgment, that will carry out his wrath, that will carry out his righteous judgment upon people because of their disobedience. So we should know that every spirit, they are subject to God. Whether good or evil, they are subject to God. They are under the control of God. Even Satan is under the control of God. Satan cannot do anything without God, not knowing anything about it. God must know anything about it. What everything that Satan will do. I don't want to go to the book of Job. We know what happened in the book of Job. How God gave Satan permission to carry out his assignment. Now, let's go to the book of Ecclesiastes 7:9. Ecclesiastes chapter 7. Be not hasty in the spirit to be hungry, for hunger rested in the bosom of food. When we see that God is punishing us because of our action, because of what we regard as evil, when we cannot be hungry with God, we cannot be hungry with God, because we will be like a fool. For us to be hungry with God's judgment upon us. God's judgment is always right. God's judgment is always just. He can't just pass judgment without any reason. And we tend to see all this as evil. But God is not evil. God always loves us. And He has a good plan for us. And He will never do anything that will make us to fall and lose hope in Him forever. Now let's look at the book, the final passage for today, in the book of Amos. And let us see what we have here. Then we should be able to have a proper understanding of God's nation. You know that God is good. He can never be evil to us. The book of Amos 5. Verse 15. Book of Amos, chapter 5, verse 15. Hate the evil and love the good, and establish judgment in faith. It may be that the Lord God of hosts will be gracious unto the remnant of Israel. You can see that God asks us to hate the evil. If God is evil, that means automatically we hate God. But God asks us to hate evil. But we mean that God is not evil. And if we love God, we hate evil. Everything, that means God is good. And have to love good. That good there is life, which is God. That have to love good and hate evil. When we hate evil, obviously love God. And when we hate evil, we do something that God wants us to do. Because we know that the consequences of loving evil is being God's judgment upon us. And we must see it as God brought upon us. And God's judgment upon us is righteous. And He can never let us to suffer ungodly. Let us look at the book of Jeremiah 29. Book of Jeremiah 29, 11 to 14. Jeremiah 29, 11 to 14. For I know the thoughts that I think towards you, say the Lord, thought of peace and not of evil. Because that God's thoughts is always good for us, not of evil. To give you an expected end. You see that? To give us an expected end. For Him, He has expected ends for us. But we must see that the expected end that God has for us, because we are suffering the evil of God, is not what we want. But actually, God knows that the expected end is sweet. That is why you are passing through it. Let us see for that. Verse 12. Now, then shall ye call upon me, and ye shall go and pray unto me, and I will hearken unto you, and ye shall seek me and find me. Then ye shall search me with all your heart, and I will be found of you, saith the Lord, and I will turn away your captivity, and I will gather you from all the nations and from all the places whither I have driven you, saith the Lord, and I will bring you again to this place, whence I cause you to be carried away. You can see that the children of Israel, God had them that He had good thoughts for them, not thought of evil. But the children of Israel, they were in the captivity when God made this statement. They viewed God as evil, punishing them for what they had done. But they never realized that God had warned them several times to hearken unto Him, to listen to the watchman trumpet, to listen to Him, to listen to His prophet. But when they fail to listen to Him, and you tell them, I'm going to bring evil upon them. When you let that body evil upon them, they see God has been evil. So they never knew that God has a very good expected end for them. And eventually they went back to their inherited land. And I give glory to God. Likewise, when we see anything that happens in our life, and we see it as evil, we should try to think deeply and try to reason according to the word of God. The purpose of that. Is it evil or good? This is from the Lord. We should know that everything from the Lord is good. God can never do it. He can never avoid that way. He's the Lord of light. He will always be there for us. And since we know that God can never do evil, we should have the peace of mind that God is there to give us a very desired quest, protect him. And then at the end of the day, we need to give thanks to God. It's about our